meditations of my heart be taken by you, Adonai, my rock and my redeemer. Пусть слова из моих уст и размышления моего сердца будут приняты тобой, Адонай, моя опора, мой избавитель.
Que la palabra de mi boca, el pensamiento de mi corazón, sea aceptable para usted, mi Adonai, mi roca y mi redentor.
Yiyu, Larapsan, Imrefi, Veheyam Libi, Las Feneha, Adonai Tsuri, Vego, Ali.
May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable unto you. If you've grown up around Hebrew or Christian scriptures, or if by chance you just really like reggae music, these words may already be familiar to you. Today, over 2,000 years after these words were first recorded, their meaning still sings true. Their truth is not secured by any unique or special position in the pantheon of human religion. Rather, these poetic words still ring true because they describe something universal and timeless, a primal yearning for expression and for belonging. These ancient words, not unlike the modern blues, are the humble prayer of an artist, a human being, a beautiful soul who was placed on this earth with a spirit inside that needs to be let out. Imagine yourself for a moment, your indwelling spirit, a light. Imagine it as a flame to be tended. Imagine that that spark inside you, inside all of us, is the same spark that moved the quill of the psalmists 2,000 years ago, the same spark that animates the minds, hearts, and bodies of every artist and every person today. No matter how you might explain it, no matter the differences of song or symbol or story, no matter the history or tradition that has brought you and us together to the present moment, that there is light within every person is undeniable. It is the purpose of the arts to nurture that light, to allow that light to shine and to grow, to cast new colors on age-old forms, and to invite celebration and reverence even amidst the darkest winter nights. Such is our task and such is our pleasure on this evening. It gives me great joy to welcome you this evening on behalf of the many bright lights who have come together in this fine program. Welcome one and all to Winterfest 2012 at Bay Path College. A great program is in store for us. Our performers will move us with words from mouths and meditations from hearts, movements of bodies and songs of voices. Please join me now in this most ancient of holiday rituals, that of appreciating and celebrating that indwelling light within and among us. Friends, let the celebration begin.
Have a
not what I think about. That's not what I see. I know what the sunlight can be. The light in the piazza. Tiny, sweet, and then it grows, and then it fills the air. Who knows what you call it? I don't care. Out of somewhere, I have something I have never had, and sad is happy. It's rushing up, it's pouring out, it's flying through the air, oh, through the air. Who knows what you call it, but it's there, it is there. All I see is, all I want is tearing.
I remember being surrounded by lights. I couldn't make out anything in particular. I can't remember anything I heard. I can't remember even if I heard anything at all. I just remember the light. I remember that everything hurt, and I remember the swirling, watery colors around me. I remember muffled sounds, like I was underwater and somebody above was trying to talk to me. I remember trying to talk back. I remember that when I woke up, there was warmth in my hand. The effort it took for me to turn my head made me want to close my eyes again. I almost did. My hand was hidden in a mess of dark curls sprawled out over a white blanket. I tried to free it and found something holding it back. I pulled again and the curls jerked up. The hand holding mine squeezed it and I looked and saw her. Eliza looked more exhausted than I had ever seen. Not even in the weeks before midterms, when she'd been preparing night and day for her performance, had she seemed so exhausted, like it had been days since she'd slept. She was smiling at me, a tired smile, and in that moment, I just wanted to sit up and hug her. She stopped me as soon as I tried to move, urging me to rest. "You too," I whispered. She pushed my hair out of my face, and I found the warmth of her hand comforting. "So, look at me." Two bony brown fingers snapped in my face, and I looked out of the light. "Sorry," I mumbled. Sophie's expression softened. "You still don't remember the accident, do you?" I shook my head. "I don't remember anything anymore. I don't know how I got here. I don't even know what day it is." "It's December 3rd. The Winter Expo is in 3 weeks. We need you to get better so we can start rehearsing again." My memory was hazy. I remember preparing with Sophie and Marisol for the Winter Expo. I remembered how important the show was for us. I remembered that I was supposed to sing, not like I could be expected to do much else. Remind me what song we're doing? I said, sounding a little too nervous. Sophie looked frustrated. I couldn't blame her. We wrote it. Remember? An original just for the show. Inside, I died. It was going to take me way too long to relearn this song. I had no idea if I could be ready within 3 weeks, especially while I was still recovering from this accident that nobody would explain to me. But I had to try. I couldn't let them down. Weeks went by in a blur. It would have been easier if my memory wasn't still lapsing, but some days I would make a lot of progress with the song and then forget everything by dinner. It was frustrating. Eliza gave me a journal to write in so that I wouldn't lose my memories, but sometimes it felt like I was reading the words of a stranger. I hated the darkness of winter. The days were short and it was always cold. It felt like the weather reflected what my life had become, dark and difficult. I would go days locked in my room without sunlight. What was the point when I couldn't find my own light? The holidays were completely absent from my mind until Eliza asked me to go Christmas shopping. I know you're Jewish, but will you go with me? You need to do something fun. Again, I had to ask the date. Time was something that didn't matter to me anymore. I didn't notice the passing of days. December 13th was her answer. She asked me later when we were in the store when Hanukkah was. I didn't have an answer for her. I don't know how much time passed before the frantic knocking on my door. It's unlocked, I called, and in burst Eliza with bright red cheeks. She draped a scarf over me before I had a chance to protest. Have you even looked outside? She asked me. You've done nothing but work in this stuffy room for weeks. You missed almost all of Hanukkah, I checked. It ends tonight, it's the 16th. I sighed. I don't have time for celebrations, I said, turning back to the page of music that was giving me a headache. Despite my words, my heart sank. The festival full of lights was always one of my favorite holidays. She stubbornly tried to get me into winter clothes again. It's snowing. Please come with me. It's Sophie's first snow and we need to show you something. Only Eliza could get me to do anything that I didn't want to do. That was probably why they sent her. Eliza dragged me outside into a flurry of snow, sparkling from the light of the setting sun. Sophie and Marisol were already out there and they looked to be hiding something. When they saw me, they grinned and pulled me over. We can't have candles inside, but they didn't say anything about having them outside. Behind them was a brass menorah with unlit candles, and one of them handed me a book of matches. You deserve a holiday too, was all I heard. My vision blurred again, and it took me a moment to recognize that there were tears in my eyes. Happy tears. My friends all hugged me at once, and all I could do was smile. It didn't matter that it wasn't a traditional Hanukkah. What mattered was that my friends cared about me. They brought me my holiday to light up the darkness of winter. When the candles were lit, I watched the glow they cast on the snow. And in that moment, I knew that everything was going to be okay. There was light in my world again.
You walked with me, footprints in the sand, and help me understand where I'm going. You walked with me when I was all alone, with so much unknown along the way. So many times have I been so
Gloria, Gloria, is King of love and light. Let every voice acclaim his name, the grateful chorus swell. From paradise to earth he came, that we with him might dwell. Venite.
Winter day. Sheets and towels frozen, clotheslines sagging, my mother's fingers stiff as clothespins, icy wind beating her face cherry red. Blue jays swooping, searching frantically for stale bread crusts coated with warm peanut butter. Running crazily in huge drifts. Water-soaked mittens pushing mounds of snow into a misshapen snowman, staring rock eyes, an evil smile. Playtime over, stomping snowy boots on a spotless floor. Cups of steaming cocoa, beckoning frosty children, determined to bask in love's moment.
Thank you. Reverend Jones couldn't be with us tonight. My name is Caitlin Burgess, and I will be reading If I Were Her in Istanbul for her. It's Wednesday, the day of woe. It's my only day off of work this week. I need to catch up on housework. I need to work on an assignment for my class that's due Saturday afternoon. Instead, I drive to the cafe and bakery 10 minutes away from where I live. The inside of the cafe is nearly empty. I approach the glass counter where there is an assortment of pastries, rolls, tarts, and cakes on display. Gabrielle greets me, pushing errant strands of blonde hair behind her ear and asks me what she can get me. If only she could get me a double shot of happy or a serving of contentment. But instead, I order a large coffee and a sausage and egg on a croissant. For here, and I find one of the small round tables in the corner to set up camp. I enjoy visiting on overcast or rainy days. There are windows surrounding the whole eatery. The walls are painted a chic pale gray, and so on days like today, it appears that there is no boundary between what is outside and what is in. The only color in the cafe comes from cake icing in the bright yellow front door. There is a row of shelves on one of the walls that holds an assortment of travel guides and books about other countries. I grab a travel magazine and on the way to my seat. I flip through the pages and settle on one photo of a bull run in Pamplona, Spain. I unzip my bag and take out my knitting project, untangling the strands as I go. There are two unfinished socks on one circular needle that I've been working on for at least 2.5 months. I read portions of the article while I knit. Gabrielle brings me my coffee and a sandwich. When I look up, I see an older man wheeling a woman in a wheelchair into the cafe. He seats her at one of the tables and goes to the counter to place their order. The woman is wearing a red 1930s style flapper hat with a red flower and a red boiled wool jacket to match. Even her wheelchair frame is a similar matching red. There are red roses thrown in the streets of Pamplona, and the bulls run through them on the way to the depths. I turn the page. The sandwich is good, and eating it steadies me a bit. I feel the warm coffee inside me. There is a photo of a beach in Istanbul. I would love to be there, bathing in the Turkish sunlight, and see the bright turquoise when I close my eyes instead of the mucky gray I see now. I look up, and the lady in red and her man are looking in my direction. Behind me are glass doors, and you can see the inner workings of the bakery and the stone oven. Certainly, this is what captures their attention. Finally, I'm making some progress on my socks. I'm well past the heel turn, and they're starting to look like they belong on feet. Gabrielle leans over the counter and asks me if I would like more coffee, and I say yes. I never drank two large coffees. My needles will be clicking away now. The man walks over and he's standing right across from me, putting his and his wife's plate in the dish basin under the counter. I look up because I can feel someone looking at me, and so it is that the woman in red is smiling at me from across the room. She loves your knitting, whatever it is, says the husband as he turns to face me. She used to knit all the time. My daughter has a pair of slippers she knit 30 years ago. I leave my coffee and bring my bag across the room to the table. I lay my socks out in front of the woman. So you don't knit anymore? I ask. The woman says nothing. Her left hand reaches under her petticoat for her withered right arm, which she raises to show me and then lets fall limply in her lap. Before I can respond, the living hand is feeling my socks. This must be a sensory treat for her, as I knit them in a basket weave pattern. Her finger traces the graduation of color, lavender to plum, to a bright sunrise pink. Yes, yes, it's 12 o'clock. It's 12 o'clock. The woman's smile is miraculously intact, and her diction is clear. But after a few more rounds of this phrase, I realize that, for the rest of her life, this woman will define everything by what is either the brightest hour of the day or the darkest hour of the night. Still, her intonations are intent and clear and direct. She's lost her language, but not her voice. Then her husband is at her side, and his hand is on my socks as well. I'm not accustomed to men paying any amount of attention to my knitting, but he touches the yard with reverence, like a monument to a memory. She knit with heavier yarn, he says. I tell her how I admire her hat, which stays perfectly balanced atop her asymmetrical body as her husband prepares to leave. They are a banner of red as they cut across the gray parking lot. I watch them from my table with my nearly cold cup of coffee in hand. I finish it anyway. My socks are nearly done. Perhaps we'll be able to knit the toes tonight. I pack them into my bag and bust my table. I close the page of the magazine and return it to the shelf. To think, if I were in Istanbul right now, I wouldn't have had the occasion to knit such a beautiful pair of socks.
It's not that unusual when everything is beautiful. It's just another ordinary miracle today. The sky knows when it's time to snow. Don't need to teach a seed to grow. It's just another ordinary miracle today. Life is like a gift they say, wrapped up for you every day. Open up and find a way, give some of your own. Isn't it remarkable, like every time a raindrop falls, it's just another ordinary miracle today. Birds in winter have their flame, but always make it home by spring. It's just another ordinary miracle today. When you wake up every day, please don't throw your dreams away.
much to do in our little town. No movie, and the video stores are too pitiful. Mostly, we hang out at each other's place, or go hiking and swimming in the woods. Our favorite spots out at the lake. That's where we build the bonfires, and bonfires are our passion. Nobody knows how the tradition got started. The best fires are in winter, when it's cold and crisp. Everybody brings their drum, rattle, or whatever. We'll watch the fire for hours. I love to catch a spark and ride it up to heaven, lifted by the beat of the drums. Christmas Eve's the biggest fire. Everybody's home from college or the military, or just home for the holidays. Last Christmas was the best. The moon was full, the air was clear and bright. It was beautiful. The fire was perfect. Gold and red and blue and green and purple. We got to drumming and it was wild, like the drums were alive and speaking to each other in that special language all their own. We drummed about 30 minutes when, out of nowhere, this new girl started snaking through the crowd till she got in front of the drummers. She wore a black dress that I should look so good in. She had raven hair and looked a bit like the fire herself. She started dancing. She danced like I'd never seen dancing. It wasn't for anybody, like a boyfriend. She was just dancing for her own self, with her own self. After a while, another girl joined her and the competition was keen. And then another girl came into the circle and another. They were dancing like sparks flaming through the night. So glorious, so divine. Finally, I put down my drum and joined them. As did almost all the girls. We were dancing like nothing existed, except the music and the stars, the cold dark air, the hot fire blazing up to heaven. I was in a trance. My body moved and swayed in ways I never thought before. Like I was learning a new language, one I'd never known before. I was dancing, only someone else was moving. Some other marvelous, magical me that I'd never met. Until that night, a me I'm so glad I found. That night, and the drums, and the night, and the stars, and the fire. Then, one by one, people drifted away. Finally, the drummers gave out too. The only person left standing was the girl in the black dress. I think she came from the fire, and returned to the fire. Because when I turned my head and looked back again, she was gone, and nobody's seen her since.
Sili Liza, Pamoja, Sili Liza.
then there was light. Good evening. Beautiful performances, aren't they? Yes. Friends, with the arrival of the winter holidays comes a time of celebration and cheer. It's a time when the warmth of families and friends is felt by many among us. It is also a time when it can be easy to forget that which matters most. A wise person once told me that our legacy is not what we say, nor will the great many of us be likely remembered for what we do. Rather, we will be remembered for how we made one another feel. This holiday season, I invite you to make it a point to remind someone of their light within. Fan the creative flames of someone who may be feeling dimmed by situation or circumstance. Truly, the world is made more beautiful and more just when more of us are burning brightly, as was our design. The chorus is fuller, the harmonies richer, the choreography more robust. This holiday season, rejoice in the rich beauty of one another. May you each know yourselves truly beloved this holiday season. May you joyfully claim the growing light within, among, and beyond you. May your many gifts achieve radiance, and may your love truly brighten the face of the world. On behalf of all of this program's players, thank you for sharing this evening with us. We wish you all a warm, safe, and loving holiday season. Peace be with you, friends.
Christmas.